Well, everybody knows when Sony put the letters ES on one of their components that they're serious. This is the flagship, or one of the flagships. The actual DTC77ES was their flagship DAT machine. This is one model down. This is the DTC75ES. Depending on who you talk to, the ES could mean one of two things. To Sony, it meant elevated standard. To the rest of us, it stood for expensive shit. The ES product line was a much more pricey product line than the conventional one. But was it worth it? Well, you tell me. You be the judge here. It's beautiful. Look at the inside of that chassis. Solid copper chassis. That's expensive. Expensive shit. So here we have the 75ES DAT machine. For all intents and purposes, this thing is as close to professional as you're going to get. It has most of your bells and whistles of your professional stuff. What it does lack that the 77ES had is it does not have the balanced XLR inputs and outputs. It has your standard RCA inputs and outputs. It has coaxial digital input and output, and it also has your optical inputs and outputs. Supports the three standards for recording and playing: 48 kilohertz, 44.1, and the long play 32 kilohertz 12-bit encoding. What it does not support is it does not support 44.1 kilohertz from an analog input. So in other words, you can copy a CD using your coaxial or digital optical input, and it'll copy that CD exactly, bit for bit, what's on the disc, at the same sampling rate. But if you're recording from an analog source, it will not sample at 44.1. Now, some have questioned, why did Sony do this? It's hard to say, but I think probably why Sony did it is that they did not want this machine being used in a recording studio environment. They did not want it surpassing and replacing some of the professional RDAT equipment that they would sell to studios, which had the AD converter at 44.1 kilohertz. Most professional equipment, in fact, all professional equipment I've seen has the 44.1. Even my more basic home deck, the cheap one, this was the expensive one. The other one that I already repaired, that was the cheap deck. It will sample at 44.1 kilohertz from an analog input. This one will not. So to record 44.1, you need to use an outboard A to D converter, basically. If your mixer's got 44.1 output, then great, you can use this deck as a slave. But if you're a budget, using it in budget recording, and your mixer is an analog output and you want to take it into this and master your CDs from it, well, no such luck. It's going to master them at 48 kilohertz, and you're going to have to convert it to 44.1 when you master your CD. So that was one of the limitations, but other than that, this deck here is fantastic. It's a bulletproof deck. It has a really beefy deck, a really beefy transport on it. Unfortunately, this transport is where the problem is on this deck, and that's what we're going to have to work on. There's nothing wrong with the deck other than the transport has a problem. If you've been fast forwarding the tape and you hit stop, the brakes do not stop the supply spool fast enough, and you end up with tape spilling, which is not a good sign. It's going to chew up the tape and eat the tape and stuff. So we're going to pull this thing apart. I've already taken the liberty of removing this stupid, I mean, this is one of those dumb cleaning wheels. Okay, and it's this foam. It's like this foam crap here. And it just deteriorates and it rots. And I've already taken the liberty of removing that because I'm sure that was probably, that little wheel that was here was probably contaminating the head more than it was cleaning it. My other deck It has a little plastic scraper that actually just scrapes the head every time you load and unload. A much better design and on a much cheaper machine than this one. This one here uses an encoder switch. We're going to clean this because, hey, it might even be this. This may be the reason why it's eating a tape. It may not be throwing the brakes on quite fast enough. But we're going to clean that encoder switch, and we're going to go through this mechanism and see what the heck is wrong with it, why it is eating the tapes. I have a cat in here, as you can hear, that is angry about something. Either that or you're just chatty tonight. So the tape compartment opens on this deck. We're just going to remove the DAT faceplate so that I'm able to remove the deck. There's a couple screws that hold this in place. They are marked with arrows, so we're going to remove the arrow marked screws down here and here and on this side, and I believe this bracket's also got to come out. That should allow us to remove the deck and work on it. The cat doesn't want out, the cat just wants to annoy me. Kind of neat because this chassis is isolated electrically from the deck is isolated electrically from the chassis. These screws that hold the tape deck in actually are going into plastic inserts, and there's another one here, as you can see, that are actually electrically isolating this deck from the chassis, which is kind of neat. Never seen that done before. Anyway, if I remove these screws, I should be able to lift the deck out and we can examine the brakes and see why it's spilling tape when it's supposed to be stopping. Oh, there's one more screw down here. And there the deck is out. We're just going to get a little container to put these screws in. Maybe convince the cat that it's time to go outside, and we'll get this deck out and take a look at it and see what's going on with it. First thing we notice when we take this deck apart is just the way it's built. Wow. It's all direct drive, or pretty much direct drive. We've got, and gear driven. We have a direct drive motor for the capstan. We have a gear driven assembly here. This would be to load, I think, load and unload the tape path. There's a little gear-driven motor here that drives the mechanism to load and unload the tape. We have a direct drive motor for the drum. We have a direct drive motor for the capstan. We have a direct drive motor for the take-up and supply spools. And we have a belt-driven motor to lower and raise the cassette compartment. Just like that. We'll zoom that camera back so you can actually see how this works. It's a work of art. So when the tape goes in, this motor rotates this pulley, which rotates a cam gear on the side here, and that cam gear lowers down the tape compartment just like that. When it raises up, and that's down. When it raises up, and of course activates the switch to tell the system it's down. When it's raising it up, switch releases and the tape is ejected just like that. On the take-up and supply reels are driven from this direct drive little reel motor. It's a little BSL DC motor. There's a couple of switches here which should be cleaned because these have a tendency to get dirty, and that's what tells the machine that there's a tape in it. Probably also turns on the little lights for the cassette compartment. So there's a few little switches here. We will be cleaning those. And I'm going to clean this mode encoder switch that's up here because these have a tendency to get dirty and cause errors. And that's all it would take, is just a little bit of dirt on there when it's switching modes to cause a motor to prematurely stop before the brakes were applied, etc. And, you know, normally what would happen is the mechanism would start to release the brakes and then shut down the power to the winding motor so that the brakes could drag the tape to a stop. Where if the winding motor stopped prematurely, the inertia on the tape spool would cause the tape to spill until the brakes applied. So it could be something as simple as a dirty encoder switch that's causing the mechanism to spill the tape. So these are things that we're going to investigate on this. This unit here hasn't seen a lot of hours. I used to do a lot of recording on this and do the majority of my playback on the other machine. And it's just because of where this was located. This one was located in my studio where I did a fair bit of track recording on this. And the other machine was located in my home entertainment system where I would be playing tapes back and listening to music and so forth. I would make 6 hour long music tapes on this and play them on the other machine. So it doesn't have a lot of hours on this thing. This machine may have recorded, 100 tapes on it, 100 4 or 6 hour tapes on this thing, if that, over its life cycle. It doesn't have a lot of hours. And that's one of the reasons. And it's been repaired once. I had to lubricate the mechanism once about 7 or 8 years ago. I had to lubricate it because the tape spools were getting gummed up. So we're going to clean this mode switch here first and clean these other switches here. And then I'm going to throw a tape in it and just see what the heck it's doing. Sorry, I had to turn the heater on there. It's mid-November here and it's about -1 or 2 right now outside. It's bloody chilly in here. Okay, what I do here is I've made myself a shield because I'm going to spray some contact cleaner into these switches. I'm not going to bother to take them out. And I want to make sure that I don't cause any of the lubricant that's in this cleaner to get into the delicate mechanism. I don't want oil flying around in where I've got my head and so forth. So I'm just making myself a little shield here. And what that will do is any spray that goes out won't go into the mechanism. It'll get absorbed by the paper. So I'm just going to give the switch a little shot. Same as on this one. And that way, as you can see, any overspray gets soaked up by my paper and is not going to get into the workings of the mechanism, into places such as the heads or any place where there's tape that could have contact with any of the mechanical parts. Because getting an oily spray into the scanner assembly could be disastrous. I remember from my days of servicing VCRs, and you get people that would get in there with the WD-40 and thinking that, oh, something's sticking, it's something squeaking, let's give it some WD-40. And they get in there and they spray WD-40 in the mechanism. Of course, they just totally destroyed their unit. So that should polish up the contacts on those switches. These two switches here, what they do is they do two different things. One switch detects whether there's a tape in it or not, and the other switch detects whether the record safety tab is switched. There's a little switch on the back of the cassettes, which basically does the same thing that the tab did on the back of an audio cassette. The audio cassette, you break the tab off so you don't accidentally record on it. On a DAT tape, like an 8mm videotape, there's a little switch. You flip it one way and it will prevent you from accidentally recording on it, and you flip it the other way and it allows you to record. And that's what one of these two switches does. The other one determines whether the cassette is in or not. And that was one of the problems on my other deck, was these two switches here were bad. My other deck though had two more switches just like this that were mounted on a little circuit board over to the side that I showed you in the video. And they were actually facing towards the mechanism, and when the sliding cam plate assembly slid over them, and they activated those switches. That was what was causing me my problems with my other machine. And that's why I always suspect that encoder switches are one of the biggest sources of headaches, whether they're linear encoding or rotary encoders or just little pin switches. All these switches that provide feedback on the state of a mechanism are prone to getting dirty, and they are prone to causing errors. So the first thing I'm going to do before I remove the switch, I'm going to get my Sharpie and I'm just going to mark the physical position where this switch is so that I can get it back in exactly the same place, because there are adjustments here. You can slide this back and forth. So I want to make sure that I mark where the switch is coming out so that I can get it back in exactly the same place when I put it back in. So once I've got the switch marked, we'll just remove these screws and that'll remove the switch. So you notice before I lifted this out that I put a little mark on here to show what position the gear is facing. And because it's not in its reset position, I don't want to cause an alignment problem. So I'm just marking where the gear was facing when I took it out of the chassis. And I'll mark on the bottom here there's a line here that's actually pointing pretty close to a little dot, so I'm just going to mark this right there. That's where it is facing, because this little line here is facing towards the dot. So this is a switch you can't really get into this thing. Some of them you can take apart to actually wipe the contacts out. This is not one of those. This one here has been, they melt the plastic over here. So the only thing I can do to clean this is I can spray some cleaner into the switch itself here and spin it around a bit. So we'll do that. We'll spray some cleaner in there and spin it around a few times and put it back in and see what happens. So I've now sprayed cleaner into the switch and I'm just gonna rotate the contacts here to clean it. And then when I'm done, I'm gonna put it right back to that little point where I marked it. Right there, and on this side, the little arrow on this side points to the other little mark that I put on there. So I know I'm back in the right timing. And now I can take the switch and just drop the switch back in. And line up the other marks that I put on the chassis and the switch. Doesn't look like it's lined up on the camera, but when I look at it straight down, I'm lined up. But you're seeing it from an angle, so you're seeing the parallax error. I'll move the camera once I get it screwed in place and show you that it is lined up with where I marked it. So as you can see, there's my alignment marks I put on the switch so that I know that I'm in the same position as it was when it came out. So now we're going to reconnect the switch to the circuitry and I'm going to roll the tape and see what happens. So with the chassis mounted on a non-conductive piece of wood here so I can observe the operation, I got a pre-recorded tape. Yes, Sony actually did release some classical music on a DAT, so we're just going to use this for our demonstration. We'll open it up and load it. And we'll just take the mechanism through its functions. Play, and it plays. We'll stop, and we'll go to forward. Okay, good. It looks like it's stopping properly, at least. It looks like it's doing better than it was. Let's try that again. We'll go into full fast forward. Let this thing get ripping here, and I'll stop it and see if it spills tape. Stopped pretty quick. I'll show you. I think we might still have a bit of a slack problem here. Certainly not to the same degree as it did before. If I go back into reverse, stops pretty much instantly. When I go into forward search or forward, full fast forward, it takes up the slack. When I stop it, watch what happens though. See that? The tape is still jumping a little bit off the guides. So it's still got a bit of a problem here. So we're going to rewind this. I'm going to take a look at the brakes. I think one of the brakes here may not be, maybe one of the brake pads. It's obviously controlled by a solenoid, but one of the brake pads must be either worn or out of adjustment. It's only affecting the fast forward though. The rewind is fine. Open the drawer. So we just need to take a look at the brake pad assembly. See why it's doing what it is doing. After examination, I find that what controls the actual operation of the brakes is the solenoid here. When the mode is first engaged, the brakes are released by the loading mechanism winding slightly to pull the brakes off, and the solenoid closes. The plunger pulls in. That pulls the brakes off. You can see the spring here in the middle of the screen next to my thumb right here. That's actually on the brake levers itself. So when it stops, you can see that these brake levers release and they drop the brakes up against the reels. It looks like one of the pads is worn out on the supply side reel, and to get at that pad, I'm going to have to take probably the reel assembly motor. This assembly is going to have to come out, I think, to get at that. I'm not quite sure how to go about that. I think I just got to take out a couple screws here, and the circuit board should lift out, and then I should be able to lift out this base assembly here and see the brake pads. But I think it's probably going to be a little felt pad has either worn out or the glue has let go on it and it's come off. But that appears to be the problem, is that it's a plastic arm with a little felt pad on it, and the little felt pad has either deteriorated or it has the adhesive that holds the felt pad on has broken, and the felt pad's either out of position or missing. And so what's happening now is just a little plastic arm that's making contact with the assembly, the real assembly, the spool. And of course, a plastic against plastic spool is not going to have the stopping power as an actual brake pad. So I'm going to remove this circuit board here, and I got to unplug this the drum motor here from it to do that as well, because that's attached right here. I'm going to take that off first, and then I should be able to remove this a plate assembly and see what the heck's going on the hubs. It's now that you can appreciate the craftsmanship that went into this. Look at the loading gears and everything. Instead of just being plastic like they were on the other machine, these are actually metal gears that move the guide assembly. This is the circuit board out of place. It was almost like this circuit board wanted to come out because the screws weren't tight. I noticed that this one here is a grounding screw, so that might have something to do with it too. If the screw is loose, that provides grounding for this board. Anyway, It should be just a matter of removing, I guess there's 1, 2, 3 screws here that hold this board in place, and this mechanism should drop out. I see at least 3 screws, and I'm hoping it's just these 3. You know, I would have thought that for a unit that's this expensive that these screws would actually be tighter than they are, but they're very, very loose. Like, there's no give at all. They just come right out. And there is the real assembly. Okay, so this is our real assembly, and I'm just gonna put these 3 screws back there. Here's our real assembly, and here's our little brake pad. And just as I thought, you can see it right here. This little brake pad is come off. See that? That little brake pad has come out of place. You can see the other side. If you look at this side over here, this is where it's supposed to be. And on this one here, this little brake pad is coming out of place. So we're going to remove the solenoid, pulls these away like that. This little brake pad, you can see it. That's the problem. So I'm going to have to re-cement that pad back onto its arm, its lever. And hopefully that is the only problem that we're going to have on this. Now let's just see if this thing unplugs. This should unplug from wherever it's plugged in, and I can work on it away from the rest of the machine. Wait, in the blue that goes, I think this is it here. Yeah, that's that plug there. So we'll just undo this plug there, and then the other plug goes down to the board right there. So now I've got this assembly out. I can work on this assembly without having the rest of this mechanism in the way. So we've got the real assembly in pieces. I think the best way to work on this will be to remove this cut washer over here, and that way I should be able to remove this lever. And if I remove this lever, I should be able to actually take the spring off and actually remove the piece that I need to work on separate from the rest of the chassis. This is where the little dental picks come in real handy. They're for more than fixing teeth. Take the dental pick there, and I'm trying to keep my camera in frame without really looking at the monitor much. Take that cut washer off and just push it up, put it out of the way. If I lift this arm out of the way like that, now I can lift this pad off of there, and now you can see where the problem is right here. You see this little brake pad has shifted position. It's supposed to be centered over here, and it just has an adhesive on the back, but it's supposed to be right like that. So now what we need to do is we need to re-secure it. Obviously the existing adhesive that's on there isn't going to do the job. It's going to start to shift again, so we have to find another way of gluing that on there. Fortunately, there are a lot of good adhesives that will do that job for me. I just got to go and get some adhesive, and we're going to stick some. I've got some right here. This stuff here is pretty good. It's called shoe goo, and it'll glue just about anything. We're going to get some shoe goo. We'll just put on the end of a little screwdriver here, and we'll just dab a bit of that on the back of that pad, and that should, when it dries, that should hold that pad in place for a good long time. So here's our shoe goo. I'm just gonna zoom the camera back a bit so you can see what I'm doing. I'll get this light out of the way a bit. And we'll just take this little lever here. We'll take the pad off. Put our glue on here. And stick the pad back on. Now we're just gonna let this dry. While I let it dry, I think I'll have my dinner. And by the time this is set up and dry, I can put this back together and put my DAT machine back together, and it'll be good for another 20 years, give or take. Well, this unit should have had a chance to set up now, so let's reassemble and see if it works. The other arm back in place. Washer goes back onto here. That holds this assembly back in place. So now we have our stopping power back again. So you can see the brake pad now is right on the will stop the hub from turning. Which is good. So now we can reassemble the real assembly. The real assembly should just drop back in, just like it came out. The arm here that sticks out goes underneath this bracket, just like that. It'll just drop into place, and then we can put the three screws back in. We can put the circuit board back in place too. Keep in mind or remember that the motor ribbon cable has to be passed up through this hole. This is for the drum motor. So it comes up. These ribbon cables are kind of fragile, so you want to kind of be careful when working with them. We'll put the circuit board back in place. There are three black screws that hold the board in place. One that goes here, they're marked with an arrow. Another one that goes up here, and the third one right in the middle of the board. You did have to take out a couple connectors. The two-pin connector that goes to the solenoid plugs in here. Three-pin connector plugs in underneath here. It's a plug right down, right there that it plugs into. And then this long cable with the multiple colored wires plugs in next to the red connector on the board. CN302 on the main board, right down here. Now these connectors are keyed, so they can only go in one direction. You don't have to worry about getting them reversed. They'll only plug in one way. Last but not least, we have to reconnect the drum motor. This connector just slides in. Just a flexible circuit board. And it just slides into the connector, and then you push it shut. Can sometimes be a bit tricky aligning it up. It just goes in just like that, and then you push the connector closed. And that is it. The mechanism is now back together, and even without tying down these wires, I'm just going to put the wires back into their connectors here, just the wire tied down, just to keep things nice and neat. But even without doing that, we should still be able to test this. So the wire connectors just snap together, and they will lock the wires back in place. Oh, they're supposed to just snap together. Not too worried about it. Okay. So now we're ready for testing. We turn the power back on to the unit. Turn it on. Open. Load our tape. Close. Our tape threads. Our tape goes into play. We have playback. Yes, we do. Fast forward. Now, if you remember before, when I hit the stop button, the tape was spilling out into the mechanism. Now when I hit stop, the tape stops pretty much instantly. Play. We're back into play. Stop. Forward. Stop. No tape spillage. You see, nothing spilling. Tape is not coming loose inside the transport here where it was before. We were having tape actually spilling off the guides. Back into fast forward. Hit stop. The tape stops instantly. We're not having any tape slack problems. So, the unit's fixed. You guys want to hear this thing work, right? Now keep in mind, this is classical music and it's probably not going to be very loud, the recording. But we'll just hold the headphones up here near the microphone. I'll hit play. And there you go. The sound quality off this thing is truly amazing. Now we'll rewind the tape. Check all the functions out. Make sure everything is working. I'm thinking, since my other deck looks so damn good with those LEDs lighting it up, that I may just do the same thing on this one. I may just put some LEDs on this deck before I put it back together too. But let's get the deck mounted back in the chassis. And then I'll look at putting some cool lights in here to light it up. I'll first dress these wires out of the way so that they're not gonna get pinched into anything. I think this unit also could probably use a cap job on the preamp. Never hurts to do preventative maintenance when you've got the opportunity, right? So as you can see, all the wires are dressed down and out of the way. And then there's plastic inserts that actually hold the chassis up from the base slightly. They're insulated. And there's another insulator here. So this chassis here is electrically isolated from the main chassis, which I find interesting, because normally you think of electronics as everything being isolated together, right? I mean, that's normally the way things are, is that you know, your mechanisms are electrically bonded to the main chassis, but on this particular unit they're not. It's running independent grounds. And I know that a lot of the a lot of the ES stuff did that. They had different grounds for, I guess everything is grounded at one point, but they don't ground everything together. They're trying to avoid ground loops. So the grounding of the chassis here is isolated, or the grounding of the mechanism is isolated from the chassis. That just seemed to be something that Sony used to do a lot of in their ES lineup. And there's the one ground screw. So it actually is bonded to the chassis, but it's only bonded in one place. It's not bonded here, and it's not bonded on this side, because they're plastic insulators. I'll show you. There are plastic insulators to isolate from the ground. And there's another plastic insulator here. But that one black screw, it's not insulated. That one provides a singular ground for it. And I think what Sony were trying to accomplish was, they were trying to accomplish that there's no, you don't have multiple grounds, because if there's a potential grounding difference between one side and the other, you could have a ground current flowing through the chassis, coming in at one point, flowing through the chassis and exiting another. And their way of thinking was that that could potentially cause distortions. So everything seems to be grounded in one point. Anyway, this is a very heavy machine. This thing here weighs about 25 pounds. I have the CD player brother to this, and it weighs a ton too. And it's built exactly the same. It's with this solid copper chassis. Copper because it conducts better than steel. Anyway, now let's just take a look at how this thing's going to look for lights. There are lights on this to begin with. They're just not very bright. I'm just going to see how they look. It's got two little incandescent bulbs already on it, but they're not very bright. I have to turn the lights down here to see them. This one's already lit up, but I think it will it'll look better if I put some more lights in. Make it brighter. Make it comparable to the other one, which is nice and bright. You can see the tape reel turning, but you can't really see the tape position. So I'm thinking if I throw one of those little LED strips like I did on the other one right up in the top here, it's going to make this thing just shine. So that's what I'm going to do. So we have to find a switch source of 12 volts. I see there's a 12 volt supply right here, and I'm going to guess that there's one of these rails is going to be a switch 12 volt line. We'll just check it. Let's check this capacitor here. Okay, there's the 14 volts there, and it's not switched. 1.1 volt. That's just the capacitor discharging. When I turn on the power, it goes up to 12 volts. So there is a point that I can pick up power right across this capacitor. The other side, of course, is ground. So if I put my LEDs across here, zero, turn it on, 12 volts. So I can pick up an LED source, light source right there. So the same as before, I've got the one with the white stripe is my positive. That's the way I've hooked it up on the LEDs. So we're just gonna tin the wire slightly. And we'll tie our positive down to that positive switch 12 volt supply, which was right here. This capacitor right there is the switch 12 volts. So now, as you can see, with my new lights in here, you can see at a glance where the tape is. Nice and bright. Really shows up the tape position. Which is what I want to see. I want to be able to see where the tape is if I'm recording or playing a tape. By comparison, I can actually disconnect. If you disconnect that one of the legs of the light, so we can see what it looks like. Original lights aren't very bright. Just had two little incandescent bulbs in there, and. Well, you can't, in the light that's in here now, you don't even notice them. If I turn out the lights, now you can see how bright the original ones were. Not very bright. And now we add the new lights. Quite a difference from that to that. I think I like option B. Well, this board's getting done right now. I just looked at it, and these caps are actually starting to leak. If I can get a light on here so you can see what I'm showing, I'm going to show you here. This is the problem with these surface-mounted electrolytics. You see, the electrolytic has already started to leak. This one's only got two caps on it, but you see what it's doing to the board? It's going to eat through the copper on the board and fuck the board up. So I'm going to change these two. They're 22 microfarad. I'm sure I can find a couple 22s around here still. We're going to change those out tonight before I put this thing back together. Good thing I decided to actually inspect this thing, because this board was on its way of becoming beyond repair. Well, it could have been beyond repair. If it eats the foil, you're kind of screwed. So let me find a couple of 22 mic caps, and we'll change these right now. There's only two of them. The other one had five. This one's only got two. So I'm going to try and find some. I'm sure I've got a couple of 22s around here I can find. It's got to go through my parts bin, and we're going to swap these out tonight. Okay, once again, we're going to use the cut out method to remove these caps, because I don't want to damage this board any more than it already is. And from the looks of things, the electrolytic has been leaking on these probably for a while, so we're just going to cut them so we can remove them. that. And then I should be able to just pick the rest of them off. The problem with these electrolytics when they leak is that they the electrolytic is corrosive. So it will damage the circuit boards, cause the traces to become damaged. So it's really quite important that these things get replaced sooner than later. Preferably before they get to the point where they're spilling their guts onto the board. By the time they're spilling their guts onto the board, it's quite often the board is damaged, and then it becomes a real problem to try and fix it. The electrolytic is corrosive. So once we've got the old capacitor, or the remnants of the old capacitor off the board, I'm just going to get some fresh solder. We're going to apply it to the board to try and clean up the mess that's left behind. And hopefully the lands won't lift. That's always the biggest concern, is that the lands are going to lift, right? As I say, this light is just absolutely useless. The springs are shot on it, and it just will never stay where I want it to go. It drives me crazy. So we'll just throw some solder on here, and hopefully this will heat up the pins, and then they will just come right off. Okay, that should fix that. So we'll bring these over and get them inside the case. Have to modify my shield cover a little bit, because this one cap is going to stick out a little bit on the top here. I can't do much about it because it's a taller capacitor than the original one, so I'm just going to use my snips. I'm just going to snip a little bit of the top cover away. Put a little board back in place. Solder down the ground tabs on it, and it should be good as new. Okay, now we can reinstall the preamp. There we go, it's installed. Turn our power back on. Play. And we have sound. You'll see the meters here showing that I have playback. I like it. We're back in business. I hope you enjoyed this video. I can put my top cover back on. Put my screws back in the side of it and enjoy this thing for another 20 years. There you go. Hope you enjoyed the video. We'll catch you in the next one. Bye.